This is going to be a demonstration of the region of the wrist and the proximal part of the palm, the carpal tunnel and the space of peroné. So let's take a look at the structures that are visible in front of us. We can see this tendon here. This is the flexor carpi radialis. Then we can see yet another tendon, a very small, very narrow tendon. In this particular cadaver, it is especially narrow. And that is this one here. This is palmaris longus tendon. So we have the flexor carpi radialis and the palmaris longus tendon, and running exactly in the middle of these two, we have this nerve here. This is the median nerve. So this is the important structure which is present in the proximal part of the wrist, and this is the site where we give a median nerve block. The median nerve is the most important structure as far as the nerve is concerned, which goes through the carpal tunnel, and we shall show the carpal tunnel just now. We have already slit open the flexor retinaculum, and we will show the margins of the flexor retinaculum just now. This is one cut margin, and we can see that it is quite thick and quite strong. It's almost a cartilaginous feel. So this is one cut margin of the flexor retinaculum. If you look very carefully, you'll see the other cut margin of the flexor retinaculum on this side, and this is the other cut margin of the flexor retinaculum. And again, when we feel it, we feel that it is quite thick and strong. So this was bridging over in this space, and that space is called the carpal tunnel. What are the boundaries of the carpal tunnel? On the medial side, we have pisiform bone. The pisiform bone is the one which gives attachment to this tendon. This is the flexor carpi ulnaris. Then we have the scaphoid on the radial side. Then we have the trapezium, just distal to that. And then again, going back to the medial side, we have the hook of the hamate. So therefore, we can imagine a triangular space, and bridging across the triangular space was the flexor retinaculum, which we have cut, and the space under that is the carpal tunnel. And now I'm going to put my finger inside, and my finger is now in the carpal tunnel. Having mentioned that, now let's take a look at what are the tendons which are passing through the carpal tunnel. This tendon which I picked up here, this is the flexor digitorum superficialis. There are four tendons. They were all enclosed in their synovial sheath. The next structure which passes through the carpal tunnel is this tendon which I have picked up here. This is the flexor digitorum profundus. This also has four tendons. So 4 plus 4, 8 tendons. And there's a ninth structure which passes through the carpal tunnel, and that is this tendon here. This is the flexor pollicis longus. All these tendons are enclosed in their respective synovial sheath. So let me mention quickly about the synovial sheath. The flexor pollicis longus has got its own individual synovial sheath, and as it goes to the thumb. And that synovial sheath is referred to as the radial bursa. The flexor digitorum superficialis and the profundus, they have a combined synovial sheath, and that goes up to the other four fingers. There is, of course, a gap in this region. This combined synovial sheath is referred to as the ulnar bursa. If there is any thorn prick or an infected prick of the tips of the fingers, especially the little finger, then infection can travel to the ulnar bursa, and that is known as T-SYNOVITIS. Similarly, if there's an infection or prick, thorn prick of the thumb, infection can travel to the radial bursa, and that is known as radial T-SYNOVITIS. So that is about the synovial sheath. Apart from the nine tendons, what other structure passes through the carpal tunnel? As I mentioned a little while back, this is the median nerve. The median nerve came from the forearm. It pierced through two muscles, and we saw the median nerve between the flexor carpi radialis and the palmaris longus. The median nerve then goes through the carpal tunnel. And in this position, if you put my finger in, we find that the carpal tunnel is highly crowded. And this is the place where the median nerve can get entrapped. It can produce this condition known as carpal tunnel syndrome, where the patient will have weakness of the thenar muscles, but there will be no loss of sensation on the palm because a palmar cutaneous branch goes outside the carpal tunnel. When a patient has got carpal tunnel syndrome, the treatment is to slit open the flexor retinaculum. And that is exactly what we have done here. We can see one cut margin of the flexor retinaculum here, and the other cut margin of the flexor retinaculum is here. Nowadays, it is not done by open surgery. Instead, it is done by endoscopic surgery through the skin itself. The point to be remembered is when we are slitting the carpal tunnel by cutting the flexor retinaculum, we have to safeguard the recurrent branch of the median nerve which supplies the thenar muscles. So let's take a look at the recurrent branch of the median nerve, and we can see that here. This is the median nerve, and we can see it is giving a branch here. This is the recurrent branch of the median nerve which supplies the thenar muscles. This has to be safeguarded. Then there can be communication between the median and the ulnar nerves. That also has to be safeguarded during carpal tunnel surgery. So these are some of the structures about the carpal tunnel. That's all for now. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Have a nice day.